Okay, well, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. First thing I need to do is point out that all of this is joint with Neil Hoffman. Okay, and a lot of times in talks like this, you want to spend a lot of time talking about stuff that you do know. But there are many things in my talk that are things that I don't know. So this is kind of an advertisement for a lot of what I think are very interesting questions in the area of geometry and exceptional Dehn fillings. So there are lots and lots of open problems in this area. I'm going to start out by giving a bit of an introduction. So our setting here, so if I write over here, that you guys can't see, right? I'll write over here. Okay. So our setting is that we are going to take hyperbolic 3 manifold. With finite volume. And we are going to, so I mean, technically we should think of this as if you compactify M, you get a compact manifold with torus boundary. So I'm just going to abuse notation a little bit and write the boundary of M is T1 through Tn. This is a disjoint union of tori. Okay, and then we're going to do Dehn filling on this manifold, which means we're going to take S1 through Sn slopes on T1 through Tn. So in other words, we're going to take isotopic classes of simple closed curve on each torus. And then we are going to glue a collection of solid tori to M so that the slopes S1 through Sn bound disks. Okay, so this is, so we're going to denote by the manifold you get from this process by MS1 through SN. So this manifold is the Dehn filling of M along slopes S1 through SN. Okay, so that's our notation. And then it's work due to Thurston that most Dehn fillings are hyperbolic. Okay, so in an appropriate sense. So those that are not are called exceptional fillings. Okay? All right, so there are various types of exceptional fillings, not very many. So you've got toroidal fillings. So this means that your Dehn-filled manifold contains an embedded essential torus. Okay, so Seifert fibered. And the cases that are of most interest are those where the fundamental group is finite, or if it happens to be infinite, then the small Seifert fibered ones are somehow the most difficult. Okay, and then also something that can happen is that your manifold can be reducible. So contains an embedded two-sphere, which does not bound a ball. Okay. So in this talk, we're mainly going to be looking at the reducible case. And we want to talk about the geometry of manifolds in this particular case. OK, so the next thing I want to define is I want to talk about slope lengths a little bit more detail. OK, so our situation, M is hyperbolic. So this means that the ends of M are cusps. So they're homeomorphic to torus cross cross an half-open interval. Actually, I'm not sure if I want. Well, you can take the ends to be closed. I don't know that I need to. Okay, so in any case, if you expand, so we're going to take horrible neighborhoods of the cusps. And we are going to expand them so that they are disjoint. So if I want them disjoint, let's do this. Okay, so and we will expand as much as possible until they bump. Okay, so if you've seen pictures like this, so in the universal cover, you've got hyperbolic 3 space is your universal cover, and your horoball neighborhoods of the cusp will lift to give horoballs in hyperbolic 3 space. So you can range to have one at infinity, and then you'll have a bunch down here. And as you push this one down a little bit, maybe I'll do that in a different color. So as you push this down, then these ones grow, and eventually they'll bump into each other. All right, and when you have done this, then what you have, so such a choice of horoball neighborhoods, this is called a maximal cusp. Now, if you only have one torus boundary component, then there is a unique maximal cusp. But more generally, if you've got a lot of them, then you can choose the rate at which you expand them. OK, but when you're all done, then the boundary of these things will be tori. So this is a collection of horospherical tori. With a Euclidean metric. Euclidean metric. Okay. All right, so each of your slopes now these are simple closed curves on your tori, and so you can straighten them out in the Euclidean metric and they will inherit a length. I'm going to denote those by L of S1 through L of Sn. OK, so there is now a theorem from the turn of the century, which is somewhat classic. So the sixth theorem is due to Ian Eagle and Mark Lackenby. And they showed that if the length of each SI is bigger than 6 for all I, then the Dane filling is hyperbolic. Okay? So this is kind of the starting point for what we're going to look at today. First question to ask is 6 sharp? And the answer is yes. So 6 is sharp. So Ian, for example, in his paper, he exhibits examples with a toroidal filling with the length of the slope is equal to 6. And then there are other examples that are known out there. So some of my favorite are Adams has, let me see if I can draw this. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So Adams showed that, okay, let's do that more quickly. The 7, 7, 7 pretzel knot. I didn't count this one. Is this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7? Yeah. Yeah. Oh, my apologies. Yeah, you're right. yes, that's right. I'm sorry. Adams and Schoenfeld showed that this pretzel knot. This is now a pretzel knot. It wasn't before. But okay, so this 7, 7, 7 pretzel knot, if you Dane fill, well, there's a surface right here. And it goes up through the twist that way. This is a punctured torus, and its slope has length exactly 6. And if you do Dane filling on this, then you'll get a toroidal manifold with an essential torus. Okay, so this is pretty cool. A question, though, is, oh, yes, sorry. Yes. Well, provided that all of them are at least 6, then what you get is hyperbolic. So you might still get something hyperbolic if you expand. You know, I mean, you could choose to expand differently so that one is less than 6, and you could still get something hyperbolic. But if you choose an expansion so they're all at least length 6, then it will be hyperbolic. Yeah. Okay. Other questions? Okay. So I have another question. So what about other exceptional fillings? So this isn't really, I have this question. It's not really my question. I can't. But, so for example, in the sixth theorem paper, of Ian's, he was thinking about this as well. So one thing that he looked at was, so if M is a hyperbolic knot complement, there's a single cusp and a single slope, and let's suppose that you fill it with a meridian, you're just going to get S3 back, right? And so Ian found examples with the length of the meridian approaching 4. A couple years later, I expanded this into more examples, but I didn't get anything better. Okay, so there are still no known examples with length. No known examples with length greater than or equal to 4. So that's kind of interesting. On the other hand, if you have a link, so you have a link in S3 and you do meridian dane filling on all of those components, then relatively recently, Matthias Gerner, I think, so he found with minimum length square root of 21, which if you do that in your head really quickly, that's 4.58. Okay. These are the longest known exceptional slopes for a finite Dane filling. Longest Okay, so this is still, it's still pretty open you can get for finite Dane fillings or for meridians of knot complements. But something that I don't know that anybody has really thought about before is the reducible case. So that's what I'm going to talk about today. Okay, so reducible case. So there are a few things that you can say without too much effort. So for example, so if your, okay, so remember the reducible case, the Dane-filled manifold contains an essential two-sphere. S, let's say. Okay, so if you undo the Dane filling, then you're gonna put holes into this two-sphere. So you're gonna the holes correspond to intersections with the cores of the solid tori. So if you remove all of those, then this is going to be an embedded manifold in M, and this is going to be a punctured two-sphere. Prime, and if you are, you know, if you don't do silly things with your surface, then you can take this to be essential. Okay, so we have an essential surface now. This is S prime. Essential surface sitting inside of a hyperbolic 3 manifold. Well, what do we do with essential surfaces in hyperbolic 3 manifolds? We pleat them. So pleat S prime. So what does that mean? One way to do this is you just take a triangulation. So triangulate S prime, take an ideal triangulation. So in other words, make sure that your edges have both endpoints on punctures. Okay, so for example, here's a nice triangulation of the two-sphere. A six-punctured two-sphere. Okay, and then you map your edges to geodesics. Okay, and because the surface is essential, then they don't disappear, and then you can map triangles to geodesic triangles. And when you're all done, maybe your surface is no longer embedded, but you have a surface now that's pleated, that's bent. So you have a possibly immersed A surface, possibly a mirror surface, with a hyperbolic structure on each triangle. Okay. Could it actually fail to be embedded? Yes, it could. Yeah, I mean, generally, you'll see something like, so from your view from hyperbolic 3 space, when you do this, you'll see some zigzaggy thing. Right. Difficult for me to draw, but so each of these is a triangle, and then there will be other triangles coming out this way that are bent in weird ways, and you may have them come around and run into each other. But because of this fact, you get a hyperbolic structure on each triangle. You can pull that back to hyperbolic 2 space. So pull back to H2. And in H2, just line up your triangles nice and straight. And when you're all done, what you have is a hyperbolic metric on your punctured surface. Okay? So given this hyperbolic 3 manifold containing an essential surface, we pleat it and we get a hyperbolic structure now on this punctured 2 sphere. Okay, so now we were talking about slope lengths. So if you take a maximal cusp over here, then the length of a slope is going to be the length of some curve. So here's SI that your pleated surface may zigzag in and out around that. But what you can say is this is going to give you an induced embedded cusp. So since they're embedded over here, you have to be a little bit careful. You get an induced embedded cusp from this. If your surface happens to bump in like this, some tricks that you have to do to make this nice. But notice here, this slope avoids all of the zigzaggedness. And so my claim is that you pick up the length of the slope SI on M is going to be less than or equal to the length of the corresponding curve on S prime over here. Right? So here, this zigzags around instead of going straight through, and so the length is longer. Also, let me just note a fact from hyperbolic geometry. You can compute this. The length of a curve on a cusp of a surface is equal to the area of the cusp it bounds. Okay. It's often shorter for me to write area than length of curve, so I will use this fact. Okay, so a quick summary then of what this says is if you've got a reducible filling, then this is going to give you a hyperbolic structure on a punctured 2 sphere, and the cusp areas of your punctured 2 sphere are going to be at least the length of L of SI. So there exists hyperbolic structure on S prime with cusp area greater than or equal to L of SI. Okay, so what about the converse to this statement? So converse, let me give you a theorem. So Neil and I show that if you have a hyperbolic structure on a punctured two-sphere. Then what? Well, it's not going to be the case that you're going to have a finite volume hyperbolic three manifold for which, not necessarily the case, for which this embeds and gives you a reducible Dehn filling. However, in any neighborhood of this hyperbolic structure in its moduli space, so in other words, in the space of hyperbolic structures, there exists an R prime with the following properties. So R prime is isometric to a totally geodesic surface embedded in a hyperbolic three manifold. Number two, I'd like to fit this on one board. A maximal cusp neighborhood of R prime can be embedded in a maximal cusp, or any maximal cusp neighborhood of R prime can be embedded in a maximal cusp of M. Okay, and then there's one more condition, which I'm going to cram in down here. Number three, Dehn filling along the boundary slope is reducible.
Does the choice of M depend on the choice of cusp neighborhood?
Yes, the choice of M will depend on the choice of cusp neighborhood. But so in summary, what this says is if I want to find the longest possible slope giving me a reducible Dehn filling, then what I really need to do is look at the structures on punctured two spheres that are giving me the maximum possible cusp areas. Okay. Okay, so the proof of this is actually pretty straightforward. So I'll just go over some of the ideas of that. So for part one, we are going to build the manifold using circle packings, so techniques of Brooks. So use results of Brooks. So you can actually, I could say that and we could walk away and be done. You can actually construct this quite explicitly. So if you view your R, okay, so your universal cover of R is hyperbolic two space, and view that as sitting as the equatorial plane inside of hyperbolic three space. Okay? Now take like a fundamental polyhedron for R. Fundamental ideal polyhedron. Right, so in between the blue is a fundamental domain for this. These are edges on the equatorial plane. There's going to be a unique circle whose hemisphere is the equator, which intersects that plane in this arc. So for each of these, you put circles, you get this string of circles on the equator, and under the gluing maps of for R tilde, you will glue these hemispheres together. Okay, so this gives you an explicit picture of basically what I'm just doing here is writing down a Fuchsian manifold. So gamma is a Fuchsian group which corresponds to R. Okay, now we're going to expand this a little bit. This is a manifold, a three manifold with are embedded inside of it when we take the quotient, but it is not at all finite volume. So this is a huge flared ends. So we want to make this a finite volume manifold. So what do? Well, we got to take out chunks of the boundary at infinity, the domain of discontinuity. So we're going to do that by adding more circles. So at each tangent point here, add a pair of circles with the same radius. When you apply, you know, this point is going to be glued to other points. When you apply the isometries of gamma, that's going to give you other pairs of circles. Okay, and if you shrink these small enough, then they will stay embedded, and you can do this for every vertex. So they all remain embedded. Da-da-da. Oh, one more. Okay, so this will get you started. And now for every edge, you can fill in the edges with pairwise tangent circles whose interiors are disjoint. And again, gamma is going to take this to another edge. And take the reflection of this so that we keep everything nice and Fuchsian. Okay. When you are done, you have a collection of green circles, which is preserved by the action of gamma. Complete this to a circle packing on the northern hemisphere. So fill in green circles on the northern hemisphere. So a circle packing, here, when I say circle packing, I mean the regions between circles should all be triangular. Typically, it's going to take an infinite number of circles to fill this in. However, if you can put in finitely many green circles, and you won't get a circle packing, but you will have mostly triangular regions between circles, such as this. And you will also have finitely many quads. Okay, and the quads you can keep packing further and further and further, but these are the reasons where you have to put in infinitely many. Okay, so this is where the work of Brooks comes in. So Brooks tells you that you can deform gamma by a quasi-conformal deformation. To some gamma epsilon as close as you want. And for this gamma sub epsilon, you can actually pack in a finite number of circles here. So this is finite circle packing. OK, so that's. What we're going to do then is we're going to take this manifold with all of these green circles in a circle packing. We've deformed. This is where I'm going to get my R prime, is from the deformation gamma epsilon. We're going to double along all the green faces. So we've still got our identifications coming from the blue, from gamma. We're going to double along all of the green faces. That's still not quite finite volume. In order to get something finite volume, we take red circles around each triangle. So they're gonna be tangent like this. And when you double in the red circles, then you get your manifold M. Okay, so M double along green. And the red dual circles. Okay, so that's part one. Yeah.
If you choose all the cusps to have the same size in your surface, then can you get this manifold to have a single cusp by gluing together in the string?
That's a good question. I don't know how to get the big manifold M to have a single cusp. Because they're just, I mean, each one of these circles out in the middle of nowhere is going to be its own new cusp. So you'd have to do something very special to the gluing of the Yeah, you can fill them all when you're done. That's true. You can. That's a good point. Yes, you could probably arrange it actually. If you fill equally here and here, then you. Yeah. Okay. So anyway, yeah, it says you can probably arrange this so that the cusps come from here. Yeah. By doing some Dane filling, but in any case, we're just looking for any manifold, and then in order to get only a single cusp. For R tilde, that would also take a little more thought. I haven't thought about that. That's a good point. Other questions?
Do you ever pass to cover the construction of it, or is it just this?
Part two. Okay, so I should call that this finite volume manifold. Let's call this guy M naught. This is not the guy that we end up with when we're done. So part two. Now we want to say that any choice of maximal cusp neighborhood embeds in a maximal choice of cusp neighborhood. So if I pick my favorite, so given a maximal cusp for R, then you can draw this. We've got this plane, R prime, I guess, is what it should be, maximal cusp for R prime. We've got this equatorial plane where the cusps are going to appear. This picture is getting a little messy, but you can see you would draw your cusps as these spheres down here. There's going to be a horosphere in 3D that corresponds to that same horosphere in 2D. Okay, so given a maximal cusp for R, you get induced a collection of horoballs. Not. Now, a priori, these are not necessarily going to be embedded. Okay, so, I mean, maybe from our construction, actually, these may start out embedded, but we don't have to worry about that at all. We don't have to think through our construction, we just say, so suppose that there is a horoball. So what could happen? They're all embedded down here because it came from a maximal cusp of the surface. But maybe up here there's another point and a horoball. That's supposed to be centered at that. Let's make that centered. Okay, so there's a horoball and these things intersect. Well, if so, then intersections. Where am I? So these intersections, they give you curves in your manifold, which are not contained in your surface. Okay, so this means, well, let's take, so what we can do is just one at a time, because these are not on R prime, there's going to be a finite cover that unwraps this and that keeps R prime. Fixed, basically. So finite cover with R prime embedded, but overlapping horospheres unwrapped. Okay. So that's going to remove all of my horosphere intersection, and then when I'm left, this finite cover will have finite volume, and this is going to be our manifold M. This is M. So there's only one more thing to check. So this actually goes back to Long and Reed showed it for totally geodesic surfaces, that you have a separability result. But yeah, now I'm hesitant it's now clear from all sorts of different things that you can do this. So, but yeah, but Long and Reed, I think, is the first result that would let you do this. Okay, so step three, we do need to show that when we Dane fill along the boundary slopes, we get something that is reducible. This is actually the easiest step. If you take S prime and then you attach to this a bunch of disks to get a two-sphere, then now you're going to have this two-sphere S embedded in your Dane-filled manifold, where these S1 through Sn denote the boundary slopes here. Each of these disks, because this is a because of the way that we're doing the filling, each of these disks intersects. So a disk intersects the core exactly once. So that means in this two-sphere S embedded in your manifold, the core of a Dane filling. So here's one of your disks, say. This is a curve that goes out and around and comes back without meeting the sphere again. So there's no way that that can bound a ball. Okay, so therefore, reducible. Okay. All right, so if I want to find the maximum length slope that gives me a reducible Dane filling, then what this theorem tells me is that I can be looking at hyperbolic structures on punctured two spheres. So now let's transition over to that. The core of one cusp could go through different disks. Yes, I guess that's true. You can just keep unwrapping it so that you only meet one cusp. Yeah, that's a good point. Yes. Yes, thank you. Okay. So, yeah. So, when being careful, that's what we get. Okay, so, all right, so. Okay, so let's look at now transition into looking at geometry of planar surfaces. So if we want to find a Dane surgery with the longest possible reducible slope, then what we want to do is we want to find a hyperbolic structure on a punctured two-sphere, and choice of cusps with each cusp having area as large as possible. Okay. Okay, so some initial words about how you would suspect that a surface with this type of a geometric structure would have very high cusp density. So this should have high cusp density. In other words, if you take the cusp area and you divide by the surface area, then this should be small, or should be, sorry, large. Okay. So your first attempt then may be to try and find hyperbolic structures on the punctured sphere with the largest possible cusp density. And this has been done. So any punctured surface. With that admits a hyperbolic structure. Admits a hyperbolic structure with maximal cusp density. Okay, so there's a construction that's due to atoms, for example. You can take an ideal triangulation of your surface. Triangulation of a surface, let's call it S. And for each triangle, give each triangle the same hyperbolic structure. That is, give it the maximal possible horoball packing, which is kind of hard to draw on the board, but it looks like this. So all of these three horospheres are tangent to each other. The area of the cusp includes these three chunks, and it's going to be 3. And the area of the whole thing is pi. Okay, so you take, for each triangle, you take a triangle, hyperbolic triangle like this, and now you need to be able to patch them together to give you back your surface. Well, this is actually straightforward because each of your lengths of your edges outside of the cusp has length 0. There's no length outside the cusp. This will imply that these triangles will patch together to give you a hyperbolic structure with maximal cusp density. So patch together to give hyperbolic structure and a cusp with maximal density. Okay, so that's a good start. Unfortunately, this is not going to work. Okay, so Neil and I found structures with the following property. So for any epsilon greater than 0, there exists a punctured sphere. I'm going to write a planar surface S. So a planar surface is a punctured sphere. With a hyperbolic structure, and embedded cusps such that each has area at least 10 over the square root of 3 minus epsilon. So this is about 5.77. Okay, I guess I didn't tell you why. So we should compare this to this structure that we would get from atoms. So the structure that we would get from atoms, notice that when you patch these things together, the area around any cusp is going to be exactly the valence of the vertex in the punctured sphere case. So let me write that down. So the cusp area from the atoms example, cusp area from atoms is going to be equal to the valence of the vertex. So if we're going to do this construction for a punctured sphere, then we're going to get a triangulation of the sphere. And it is a fact, which you can check. I think this is due to Euler. Any triangulation of S2 has a vertex of valence less than or equal to 5. Okay, so the maximal slope length you're going to get from this densest possible cusp area is actually just going to be length 5. And we wanted to do better than that. So we were able to get 5.77, which is less than 6, which is good. It should be. But not a bit less than 6, really, in the grand scheme of things. OK, so maybe let me just say a few words about the proof of this. So yes, I think that that's optimal. So I'm going to go, all right, to make this more fun, conjecture, this is best. OK, so we have a particular construction that gave us this 10.77, or not, sorry, 10 over the square root of 3, 5.77. And I have a little bit of time. I'm going to go through that a bit. You're going to see that there's some inefficiency in our construction. And so perhaps if you are more clever than me, well, you are more clever than me, but perhaps you can figure out a way to use some of this inefficiency to transfer more length into the cusps with there are going to be some cusps with more area than they need, and then there are going to be the cusps with that are realizing this bound. So there may be a way to push some of that area into these. However, we tried this many different ways on computer. We tried over with many different examples. The best that we could do in all cases, the different constructions that had the optimal results, they all had this 10 point, or they're 10 over square root of 3. Yeah?
Just to make sure I understand, by the theorem that used to be over there, your conjecture is equivalent to the statement that the maximal length of a reducible slope is 5.7.
That's right. So our conjecture is the maximal length of a reducible slope is 5.77. All right, so here's how our construction goes. We're going to start with the densest possible packing via atoms. But we're gonna choose a triangulation so that this is going to give us the longest slopes possible. So it's possible to choose, so we're going to choose a triangulation of S2, where all the vertices have valence either 5 or 6, or except for 12 with valence 5. Okay, so these types of objects are actually quite well studied, including by chemists. To these things called fullerenes. So this is an applied math doc. You didn't know it. All right. What's that? Yes. OK, yes. OK, so on the vertices with valence 5, this densest packing gives you length 5. But everywhere else, you have length 6. And so what we're going to do is we are going to borrow length. So if this guy has length 5, then there's a triangle. Okay, so on a triangle on one of these 5 valent vertices, this has length 1. This is going to be, I'm going to arrange my triangulation so that these guys are well separated. Okay, so let's make these far apart. So if this is a triangle adjacent to a vertex of valence 5, the length here is 1, the length here is 1, the length here is 1, but this has valence 6. So this one doesn't need to be 1. I can borrow some of the length of this thing and add it to this. And so a way that we do that to make the construction easy is we spread things out. So if you spread this a little bit, so make that have length c greater than 1, say, then this is now going to have length 1 over c, and this is going to have length 1 over c, so slightly less than 1, typically. An issue, though, is by spreading this apart, we may have, remember, to glue this up, we were able to glue things because all of our edge lengths were length 0. Here's an edge that doesn't have length 0 anymore. This may not glue up. Well, the fix for this was, let's just, instead of looking at triangles, let's look at quads. So if we put in another triangle like this, then this is going to have length c as well. So we're going to start with one of these triangulations, and for our valence 5 vertices, we're just going to take adjacent quads, and we're going to spread things apart a little bit. You could change the shapes of the cusps and keep the hyperbolic metric the same, but you don't have enough. You don't really have much room. Yeah. So I'm changing the geometry completely, but I'm just pulling this triangle, replacing it with so this would be a quad really. I'm replacing a quad that looks like this with all of these sides length 1 with a quad that looks like this, where this side has length c, this has length c, and these are 1 over c. Okay. And if I do this for any quad, because these lengths are still 0, so this is still 0, 0, 0, 0, I can just put these into my original structure however I want. Okay. All right, so once you've done this, now everything else still has length 1, 1, 1, 1, right? This guy, you can make your C, maybe we can make this, this was 5, now maybe we've got 5.5 here, and maybe we've got 5.5 here. We can share equally between these vertices the length. But we can do better than that by now borrowing length from this vertex over here. So you can repeat this process. So you can replace this quad with a quad with a similar stretching going on. And you can do this as many times as you want. And so what we showed in our construction is that, well, this has a limit. So this replacement by quads, I should really erase over here. Limit, and that limit is just this 10 over the square root of 3. Okay, so.
So could I ask a question? So you started off with this triangulation, and then there's this process where you decide some triangles should form quads?
Well, I group them together. So I think my triangulation, I'm going to subdivide my triangles too, maybe is another way to do this. So I have 12 vertices that are valence 5. If I don't have enough space, let's just put in a lot more triangles. So these now, if I do this for all of my triangles, I just replace. So I have a triangulation of S2. I'm looking for any structure on a punctured sphere that'll work. So just, make these all ideal vertices now. I'm putting more and more and more vertices in, but now I've got lots and lots of sixes to work with, to borrow from.
And then you're sort of taking some of those pairs and
trying to form
a quad.
Yeah, so this is a quad.
And then you're deforming the hyperbolic
quad. Yes, that's right. That's right. And here's a quad, and here's a quad. That's right. So the green is going to borrow edge length from these vertices to get more length there. And now these two are going to borrow from these guys to get more length there, and so on and so on and so on.
You're really talking about like along the horiball,
yeah, cusp area. I get more cusp area, yes. Yeah. Does that make sense? Other questions? Okay. So just a couple of comments at the very, very end. I said I would watch the clock, and I'm watching it. We're almost done. This is actually seems to be very closely related to another applied math problem. So Tams, I think that's how you say his name, he was a botanist, and he was interested in how pollen was packed around a sphere. So I guess a grain of pollen looks like a sphere, and there are different sized circular caps that you are going to be packing onto this. And he wondered how you could do this most efficiently. So for fixed n, find the largest Euclidean diameter of n equal circles. Can be placed on a sphere without overlap is this problem. So if you take our problem and instead of, I just told you that I can subdivide and add as many points as I want. Stop doing that. Fix the number of points. For a given fixed number of points, the hyperbolic version of this problem would be, how do you fit these points? How do you get a hyperbolic structure on this thing so that the cusp area is, so every cusp has equal area and that area is maximum possible. So this really is a very close analog of this problem. I should say a little history on this problem. This is, I think this problem is from the 1930s, and it seems to be very, very hard. So this is only known for a finite, for a very small number of n. There's some computer evidence, computer conjectures for larger numbers of n. But for example, I have data going only up to 50 is what we have. When we tried to test out our conjecture, using the configurations coming from this, we found that the largest possible Horrell-ball area from that configuration was about 5.6. So we're still conjecturing 5.77. Okay, so I'm gonna stop there.